point of the sutras is that the sutras were never supposed to be closed. They were never supposed to be closed. Yes, it's okay. It's okay. Yeah. He's observing certain people have come, so he's just acknowledging it. The sutras always, the Yoga Sutras, they always were designed, especially because Patanjali was probably the greatest psychologist the world has ever seen, and he was certainly one of the greatest yogis the world has ever seen. I read somewhere, somebody said that he knows about chakras and nadis, but he doesn't know about kundalini. If you know about chakras and nadis, won't you know about kundalini? How absurd can you get? Because he's never used the word kundalini. That is true. But the word kundalini is never there in the, it's not there in the Vedas, it's not there in the Upanishads either. You need to figure it out, that what are they talking about, because it is done very densely. That's besides the point. But the way Patanjali designed it was, you listen to the sutra, you are taught the sutra, and then you develop a relationship with it. You start thinking about it, you start working with it, you treat the sutra as a sort of personal guide or mentor or guru. Which is why the sutras are really short, you know. I mean, I think the longest sutra just has some 20 words or something like that. That's it. That is the very longest sutra, and a lot of people are like, this person is becoming garrulous and verbal, you know. He should have condensed it even further. So we had our three famous definitions of yoga. Anybody remember them? Verse 1, verse 2, verse 3. Atha Yoga Anushasanam, which is the first one. Chapter 1, verse 1. Yoga, Chitta Vritti.
Nirodha.
Nirodha. Third one. Tadadrashtu. Swarupe Vasthana. Now, please either download these things or take the, learn them, because what is flowing from me in these pravachans is quite unique. It is stuff that is not there in the other commentaries, which is as it should be if I am just repeating what is in the other commentaries and what is my value to it. You may think that this is all bumper and very high funda, but actually you will benefit tremendously if you understand. And you try to understand what is going on. So, verse number 3, I have this most unique interpretation. Nobody has ever got an interpretation like that. Tada drashtu swarupe vasthanam. And then the seer resides in his own rupa. Which, if he has done all the work that he needs to do, if he has done all the psychological work that he needs to do, if he has done all the emotional work that he needs to do, is fine. If not, we saw it can be, yeah. So the seer does not reside in the truth. The seer resides in his rupam. But rupam in itself is limitation. I went into all that very, but you must remember that verse, because otherwise you cannot come into the verse number 4. We are still only in 4 verses. The next talk on Patanjali that I do, the 2 verses are interlinked. So we'll finish 2 verses at that time. We'll go a little faster also. We'll try maybe once a fortnight, something like that. So, tada drishtu swarupe vasthanam. And then the seer resides in his own being, or in his own form, in his own. So we went into that. So the next one is vritti sarupam. Not swarupam, but sarup. Sarup. Now remember, Sanskrit is a language where uccharan is very important. Enunciation, pronunciation is very, very, very important. So confusing swarup and sarup is very easy, but it's not the same. Sarupam is not swarupam. Swarupam is your own form. Sarupam is your social personality, so as to speak. How you conform to the world. Yeah? How you conform. Rupam, form. Yeah? The form or personality that you assume so that you can function in the world. The things that you learn from your family, from school, from interaction, from your organization, these kind of behaviors are acceptable, these kind of behaviors are not acceptable, these kind of things are rewarded, these kind of things. So they all tend to create. That is not how you dress, that is not how you behave, that is not how you talk. All those are not, maybe they are you, but usually not. They are not your swarupa, they are your sarupa, they are your conformities. So, vritti sarupyam itaratra. In some they say vritti swarupye mitaratra. Now, that is because these sutras are written in conjoined Sanskrit. Have you seen the conjoined Sanskrit where the letters all run into each other like a train,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, if you look at the way it is written, it can actually be looked at swarupya itaratra, sarupya mitaratra, or swarupya mitaratra.
Mm.
It's actually possible.
Mm.
After so many, almost a year, we are coming to the anniversary of our first meditation, still phones are not silent, all right. So, there is no, there is no consensus on this matter. In many books, you will find mitratam, in many books you will find itratam, but there is consensus on what the word means. It means in other states, or in other conditions, or in other states of being, in other times. So whether mitratam or itratam doesn't mind, for our convenience we'll stick to itratam. Yeah. The Indian books tend to be mitratam, the foreign scholars tend to be itratam. So, pata nahi kyun, but it's there. I have not found as yet a comprehensive answer. Everybody interprets, because it's a co-joint word. It's a single word. The whole sutra is just one word. Vritti swarupyam sarupyam itaratra. The whole sutra is one word. So it becomes a little difficult to figure out what. Now, what is vritti? Remember what we said vritti was? Yoga chitta vritti nirodha. When the modifications of the mind stop, then that is yoga. When your mind stops leaping up and down like a monkey, then you are in yoga.
Mm.
Yeah. So basically, when you are mindless, you are a yogi. So what does this mean? Vritti sarupyam itaratam. At other times, the rupa, it is not residing in swarupe vasthanam. Where is the rupa residing? It is residing, the vritti, it is residing, the rupa is residing in vritti. Now we are in trouble. Are you understanding what I am saying? I think people are, yeah, actually bumper gaya. Yoga chitta vritti nirodaha tada drashtu swarupe vasthanam. When the vritti stops, when the modifications of the mind stops, the drashtu, the seer, he resides in his own form. Itaratam, at other times when you are not in swarupa, whatever the quality of the swarupa, we talked about that. That the swarupa might actually be quite damaged and it might not be at all in any ways. Whatever, suppose you are out of your swarupa, you are now in social construct. Sarupam, where does the sarupam stay? Itarate, where does the sarupam? In the vritti, in the modifications. So when we are not in our authentic self, or we are not in our authentic form, we are in the
modified form.
What did I say vritti was? It meant whirlpool. Yeah. So we are living in the
whirlpool.
In the whirlpool of the world. Oh Mata. Oh Mata. So here he has Atha Yoga Anushasanam. So immediately, if this is true, we know Anushasana has gone somewhere. Itaratra, at other times. What other times? From itaratra. What other times? What is that meaning of that other times? Other times means when you are not chitta vritti, nirodha. When the chitta, when the mind is not still, when the mind is still, when the modifications of the mind have ceased, you are in your authentic form. Not still in the truth. But at least that is a higher level of vibration. You are in your swarupa, your authentic. We have that saying, no? Ab apne asli swarup mein aa gaya. Yeah, the person has revealed the truth of his or her nature. We say that, no? That is their authentic self, that is their authentic vibration, that is their authentic personality. But Swarupa is not the only personality we have. We have Sarupa. We have this social construct. That which is conformity. That which is conformed. That which we have a stimulus response. Anyways, the vritti is stimulus response. Yeah? Whatever can get a response out of you is vritti. I explained that. Anything that can trigger you, anything that can knock you off center, anything that can get you to respond, anything that can create an emotional change in you is a vritti. So now he started off at the highest peak, Atha Yoga Anushasana. All right. And now he is coming down, okay. You can't deal with that, next level. You can't deal with that, next level. You can't deal with that, next level. So now we are coming to the thing. Most of the time, is why he says that other times, I don't know. He should have just bluntly said most times. Vritti Sarupyam. Because where do we have authentic responses to situations? Most of the time we are doing what we know will be rewarded socially, no? Or not punished at least. How many times do we actually do exactly what we want to do? How many times do we do that? What Patanjali is trying to show is that, so it's fine, you might even come to that moment where you hit your first samadhi and you have that, you know, chitta vritti ho gaya. And as I said, when I explained the next verse, I explained why chitta vritti is not enough, you know, because swarupa is fine, but you know, swarupa is not the highest possible. That is who you are. Vritti creates our personality. Now we are in trouble. Our personality is a construct. Our personality is a conformity. Now, for large parts of Indian culture, what is wrong with conforming? That is exactly what we should be doing. No? The whole Khap Panchayat is basically about conforming. Yes, this is against our culture, this is against our tradition. In other words, confirm, confirm, confirm. But if you confirm, if you are in Sarupam, you are not free. If you are in Swarupam, you may or may not be free, but at least it is a better state of being than being in Sarup. You are not in a state of conformity, because the minute you are in a state of conformity, it means that the vritti, which means, vritti actually means you are a helpless victim of stimulus response. You have no control over. You have no control over. And the vrittis are also all the expectations that people set up. You are doing a spiritual course. Are, you should be kinder, gentler, humbler. Yeah? You should not have temper. Where did all these extra shoulds suddenly manifest? So this is the danger. This is the problem. Even when the mind stops, even when the, not the mind, even when the vritti stops, vritti nirodha, it doesn't say destroy. Nirodha, ruka, swarup mein rehte hain, but the vritti is constantly looking for a way to grab hold of you again. So you are very happy, you've come to the great avatar, Patanjali, to learn yoga. And he tells you, this too is part of the game that you are playing. This too is part of your, because in our culture, in other cultures it is actually difficult, because in other cultures when they try to be spiritual, it is actually fresh and new, because they are not very spiritual. But in our culture, because we've been doing nothing else, there is a whole false personality, there is a whole swarupyam that we can create around being spiritual. You know, you dress a certain way, you act a certain way, you know all the standard triggers that we have. And we actually think we are growing and evolving when all that is happening is Vritti Sarupyam Itaratra. Now again, this is one of those verses where everybody just glides over it. I find it quite staggering. At other times, he is subject to the modifications of the mind. Hello, what do you mean by that? Why are you just ignoring that whole sutra and jumping forward? Because the other sutras are interesting. The other sutras tell you what are the problems, there is a klesha, klesha. They teach you about what are the negative sides of the mind, what are the positive sides of the mind. So, all tick marks for improvement. You know, you can start. But he has thrown the challenge straight up. He has thrown the challenge straight out. If you are not in that state, if you are not in that state of heightened intensity, heightened awareness, call it samadhi, call it enlightenment, call it being in tune with the force, whatever it is. If you are not over there, then you are not your authentic self also. And being your authentic self is not enough. That he has anyways made it very clear. You are not even your authentic self, you are only a social conformity. You are only a miserable product of vritti, of stimulus response. So now what? Now what? Let us give up, yes? This is the reason why everybody runs to the Bhagavad Gita, you know. Because the Bhagavad Gita doesn't dishearten you and explode all your... It gives you everything at the kind of vibration that you are comfortable with. You want to fight, you fight. You want to sit, because it gives all prescriptions. You know? It is a very prescriptive thing. Here are things to do. You know, and as long as people are doing something, they can always live in the comfortable illusion that we are achieving something. The two are quite different. Vritti Sarupyam Itaratra. We might be doing and we are getting a lot of social validation. But all that is happening is that Vritti Sarupyam, you are just deepening your conformity, you are not becoming free. Now people say Moksha Prapti. They don't have a clue what they are talking about. Because you have to take moksha from yourself first. You have to be free from your own nonsense first. But no, go on pilgrimage, do so many malas, fill up tons of notebooks with Ram Nam, whatever, and you know, moksha prapti. Swarup bhi nahi hai, sarup hai. So what's he communicating? Why is he pulling these hand grenades one after the other and throwing them right into our laps? You know? Because he's very clear. If you really want to do this, if you really want to be a yogi, the first thing is stop deluding yourself. Itaratra, it's almost like titir bitir, you know. I used to wonder, where did this phrase titir bitir come from? I think from here. Itaratra. Because it's not a word which has any particular meaning. Yes, it just sounds scattered. Yes? Mm-hmm. That's exactly what it is conveying, no? Scattering. Mm-hmm. Right? Titir bitir. Itaratra. The point is, vritti has so many meanings. It means modification, it means fluctuation, it means change, it means behavior, it means function. It means all aspects of life is vritti. But what does it modify? It modifies the chitta. So at verse number 4, you are no longer even functioning at your chitta, you know, you are no longer even functioning at a sort of higher level of consciousness or even the aware of consciousness. Now you are on automatic pilot, that's what he is telling you. Sarupyam has so many things, but one of the worst, because Sanskrit is a polysemous language, it is a where each word has multiple meanings. One of the meanings is actually assimilation, where we lose our individuality and we are just dissolved into a collective. Which by all traditional notions is actually the best way to be, yeah? Don't ever think an independent thought, don't ever do an independent thing, and certainly don't wear clothes that are different from what everybody is currently wearing, because you know that is like... Then the point I am making is resemblance. It looks like, it resembles, a resemblance is not still an authentic reproduction, it is just like, so you are trying to resemble somebody. Okay, that works, you know, I spoke on Kita Brahmari Nyaya. Remember that if you focus with Samyama, he comes to Samyama much later. Much later he comes to Samyama, where he explains how you can use Samyama and what it can be done and everything. So this has really been, and again, because I do not know why this verse has been neglected. Because everywhere you'll find the same thing. You'll find this one quickly they will explain it. At other times he is subject to the modifications of the mind, as if it means nothing. Why that is so is because the commentaries were usually written by Swami types who were living in ashrams. So it was easier for them to ignore that. Because their kshetram is limited, their field of action is limited. They have certain set standard protocols to operate, what to do, how to do. So it's much easier for them not to have a fluctuating mind. But Patanjali didn't write it in an ashram. He didn't write it for people in an ashram. He was just exploring the human mind, the possibility of liberation, the possibility of enlightenment. So he very clearly put, Tada drishtu swarupe vasthana. Okay, grand, wonderful, with multiple other issues to it. The next line he just comes out straight. How did people ever get to the end of this book is what I used to wonder sometimes. How can you say that I know the Yoga Sutras or I have learnt the Yoga Sutras? Because each, you remember when Ganapati was taking dictation from Vedavyasa for the Mahabharata, his condition was that my hand should never stop moving. And Vedavyasa's counter condition was that until you understand the verse, you should not write any further. So occasionally he would put in this very dense and knotty verse so that Ganpati would have to think about it, and then that time in the pause that he got, he would compose the other. So this seems to be something like that. The Yoga Sutra seems to be something like that, where you have to take this pause, you have to take this, hold on. He didn't put it out there because he wanted to fill up the number of pages. Not even 200 verses in the entire Yoga Sutra, so it's not a problem of filling up space. If he has put it there, and he's put it there as the fourth verse in the Samadhi Pada, right up in the most important thing, there is a reason for it. The next two verses are fun because, you know, there is nice classification in there, and there is, this is the good side, this is the bad side. So the whole nursery moral school is there, you know. This is the moral of the story, this is what we should aim for, this is what we should avoid. And he's telling you that is all mind games. Because Vritti Sarupyam Itaratra. At all other times, it's not even at other times, it is actually at all other times. Other times from what? Chitta vritti. Whenever you are not in chitta vritti nirodha, you are in, not even in swarupam, you are not even in your authentic self. You are in your conformity self. You are in your social construct. You are in your social personality. Not even your real personality. You are just a stimulus response whirlpool. Then we can move forward and see what are the good sides, what are the positive things, what are the negative things. But please get this clear. I am not acting as a free individual. I am not even acting as an authentic individual. Now, a lot of trouble can be caused from there also. You know, very few people were as authentic as Hitler, but that is the wrong kind of authenticity. We don't want people to be authentic like that. But in general, it is better to be authentic. In general, it's better to be very grounded in your own self. It's better to come to your true nature. Because there is no psychological growth and there is no enlightenment without accepting yourself as you are. Good parts, bad parts, indifferent parts, all have to be accepted. And when they are all accepted, and you finally say, alright, this is who I am, this is what I can do, these are the things I am not going to waste any more time, then at least you are in Swarupa. Mm. Then at least you come to your authentic self. The problem is, in the culture, this is the problem. The reason why people glide over these verse number 3 and 4 is because in the culture, if a person has achieved samadhi or a person is enlightened, then immediately we start projecting holiness onto them. Yeah? Mm-hmm. They are good and kind and gentle and they have all the knowledge of the universe and, you know, the whole childishness. That, you know, my mother and father were pathetic disappointments, but now I have found somebody who will be mother, father and God all. So the minute we say that somebody is got a certain siddhi or got a certain level of attainment, we forget ki swaroop kya hai. What is the authentic self of that person? Is that something that vibrates? Does he have certain deficiencies? We refuse to accept that they may have limitations. We refuse to accept that they may have weaknesses. We refuse to accept that they can be tired. Because, you know, as I was just complaining recently to somebody, that people think that I am made of stone and steel and I got lava instead of blood. You know? No doubt it is my fault because of the way I project myself. But, you know, the point of the matter is, this is also flesh and blood. This also has tiredness. How can you be tired? You are a yogi. So this notion of the swarupa of the spiritual person has become very, I don't like to use that word, but actually it is true, it has become very perverted. Or perverse. Because as I always say, to the great consternation and disapproval and embarrassment of people, what, spiritual people don't fart over? They all get, why did he say a thing like that? I'm like, do you think? This happened to Swami Rama because he went to the US and some lady had learnt about yogis and all the standard miraculous nonsense. And when she heard that he goes to the toilet, she was like, he can't be a yogi because the yogis do not need to excrete anymore. The problem is there. The problem is that we have completely forgotten what Swarupa and Sarupa means. Because there is only Divya Rupa now, you know. When there is somebody who is spiritual, there is only Divya Rupa, the divine form. And I am not saying the divine form doesn't exist. Just today in the Arya Yoga Sangha, I posted a comment on Sri Aurobindo where he said that people having the difficulty about surrender, next week I will talk on that, surrender, Sharanagati, that the test is not what kind of personality the teacher has, the test is can the teacher awaken the divine in you. Mm. Because the divine in him is awakened, uska jagran ho gaya, aapka jagran kar sakta hai. Can he awaken you or not? Here is again the problem, because we are confusing Swarupa and Sarupa, and then both of them we are ignoring and we are only wanting to see this Divya Rupam, yes? We are only wanting to see this bright shining light, and you know why? The devas are not valuable in our culture. The human being is valuable in our culture because devas cannot get enlightened. The devas have no flaws. Yes, it is true. Deva means bright and shiny. That is what it means, luminous. But they cannot get enlightened. Only this residing in the Annamaya Kosha, only this can get enlightened. So this is the most important and the most valuable thing. But because of all these nonsense projections that we have, because we we stopped being a psychologically mature and a psychologically sophisticated country and we started becoming childish or senile, I do not know which. Probably a mixture of both. Ek to nobody understands what chitta means, nobody understands what vritti means, you know. So, okay, you know, those are slightly difficult. But this sense of refusing to work with reality, I would say that is the core, and Patanjali works with reality. It's very easy to talk about what happens when you are enlightened. You can go on forever about that. It's very, very difficult to teach people how to become enlightened. So wherever you see any group or organization that is constantly talking about enlightenment and all the literature is about enlightenment and very little about the processes how to achieve it, be a little careful. Because that is not even Swarupa, that is Sarupa. So this refusal to see that a certain activation, of course he goes into all the kind of siddhis and the abilities that come, all that. But he has warned you right in the beginning, so Patanjali cannot be blamed for it. Patanjali cannot be blamed for the wrong turn that the culture has taken, because he did not say satya vastanam, he said swarupe vastanam, and then he said itaratra vritti sarupyam itaratra. Right at the beginning, he made it very clear that just because a person has attained something, just because a person has come to a certain ability or even miraculous levels of ability, but is that the current understanding? What is the current understanding? The person cannot be angry, the person is always smiling, you know, like that Arun Govil in that, when he played Rama in that, yeah, the permanent divine smile, you know. Yeah. Rama was known as Naravyagra, the human tiger. Do you think he was always smiling? And he was taught by the Rishi Vyagra, Vishwamitra. And all the rishis, only one rishi is called Vyagra. That is Vishwamitra. And Rama must have been a very, very good shishya. He would have modeled himself completely. But that perpetual, that smile, you know, it used to really get my goat, you know, that whole notion of, because it gives this wrong impression of what spirituality means. It gives this wrong impression of what a higher consciousness means. Spiritual people are always intense. And one person cannot know all. This other problem of projecting all knowledge onto the teacher, all knowledge. One person cannot know all the methods and all the systems. Now, if he says that, immediately people run. So he gives the divine smile and maintains very diplomatic silence. He is not even in Swarupam anymore. He has come into Vritti. Sarupyam Itaratra. This, right here, the clearest warning and the clearest filter is placed. Whenever you are not in Samadhi, whenever you are not in Chitta Vritti Nirodha, Vritti Sarupyam Itaratra. He doesn't say that only ordinary people are. Tada Drishtu Swarupe Vastanam. The Drashtu, the seer, the sage, the enlightened person, at other times, Vritti Sarupyam Itaratra. The Drashtu also, the seer, the sage, the enlightened person, at other times he is also subject to vritti. Now, who is at fault? Is Patanjali at fault? Is yoga at fault or is the culture at fault? Because we don't allow our spiritual people to be human beings. Is it not true? Ramana Maharishi, towards the end of his life, he had become very weak. His disciples would stop people because people would come, basically jump on him, either embrace him or catch his feet and not let go. Now the man is over 70. He's frail. Yes, of course he's Ramana and he's like, you know, he's the pinnacle of the old style yoga that nobody, you know. But he's still, no. He's public property. he has become enlightened, he's a great avatar, he's avatar of Skanda, whatever, so he's public property. Now, any of us can do what we want with him. But as Patanjali said, that the enlightened, the drashtu, the person who sees, the seer, that he is not subject to these things. He did not say so. So where did this mindset come in? Much, much later. And the reason, because these two verses are ignored, everybody slides over them and goes into, oh, the modifications of mind. This is a negative, this is a positive. Let us enhance the positive and find ways to manage the negative. Everybody gets into this management jargon straight away. And he has been warning you. He has been warning you. Tada drishtu, not satye vastanam, not arupe vastanam, tada drishtu swarupe. No matter how much he, because he has taken vasana samaskara, has created a particular kind of body, particular kind of personality, he can be the highest vibration of that particular formation or that particular possibility he can be, but he will still have swarupa, which actually is a tremendous breakthrough for most people, because most people never come to swarupa also, except when they are very, very angry. That is when people are in. I remember one yogi saying, and I've heard many yogis say it, so it seems to be a standard. They're like, all this shame and social conditioning you have about this is right and that is wrong, and the minute you are in love with somebody, you can't wait to become naked. You know, your entire bodily conditioning goes out of the window immediately. So, in passion, height of passion, height of anger, we occasionally find our swarupa. That itself is so rare, you know. That itself is so rare. Most of the time we are not even in swarupa. What rupa are we in? Sarupa. Or vritti sarupyam itaratra. At other times, I am like, wrong translation. At all times, you know. Constantly. Actually, itaratra should be translated as constantly or ongoingly, you know, something like that. Yeah. All bumper, huh? No, these are important verses, because he is not a fool. He put them right in the beginning of the Samadhi Pada. Very, very clearly he put it here. Now we'll talk about. Because he knows what will happen, he'll write about the siddhis and the abilities that come, and then people will only, they won't realize all the limitations. It is amazing, this verse is even more neglected than verse number 3. Sometimes they don't even bother to give a commentary, they'll just translate it and jump to the next verse, because the next verse, verse number 5 and 6, you get all the meaty stuff, you know, you get all the things to do. you get all the things to engage with. Quite extraordinary. So when you ignore sutras of such profound depth and meaning, and you run because there is something to do, then you know that itself says that some problem has happened in the psyche of the country. However, we do the best we can. Okay? Sarvam Shanti.